Okay, thanks, Jerry. Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming. The Institute, we have a bit of a funny name. Where does it come from? It's actually from two of the founding fathers of marketing science. And I can at least say I had the honour of working with Andrew and climbing a very small mountain in the south of France with Frank. But these two gentlemen, they were the ones who really pioneered the idea that marketing is a science. We have laws, we can look at empirical data, and we can describe and explain the world that we're in. And so we take their philosophy and apply it to the research that we do. And you'll see it in the data I'll be presenting today, when it's not too data heavy, this presentation, but we do have lots of, you see slides with like 20 categories listed, because that's the work we do. We look over different categories, different time, different countries, for the real generalizations about how marketing works. We like to promote our corporate sponsors. The work we do would not be possible without their support. And as Jerry mentioned, they come from around the world, and many of the world's largest marketing companies support the research that we do, which is a pretty cool effort for little old Adelaide, isn't it? The companies in black there, the darker ones, are ones that actually have global membership to us. So all of their offices around the world have access to the research that we do and support the research that we do. I'm presenting from one of the many research streams at the Institute, and I'll just put them up so you know there's lots of things that we're doing, and this all feeds into how we interpret the work that we do. So we not just look at any one aspect of marketing, but we look across how all of them fit together to understand how we can more effectively do the marketing activities that we engage in. Okay, so that was just a little bit about the Institute, and now I'm going to talk about the key topic for today, which is all about word of mouth. And I will say, I started my research in brand equity, and brand equity has always been my major love. It's kind of like my first child. Word of mouth, I kind of stumbled in by accident. I was asked to do a presentation at Turner Broadcasting on a report that we just issued about word of mouth. And Turner Broadcasting is a TV network. They own CNN, Cartoon Network, a whole heap of different global networks. And I thought, oh God, we've done lots of research on word of mouth in services. We've done nothing on TV. I wonder if it applies there. And so that took me on my journey of starting to learn about word of mouth and starting to research it. And I just wanted to have a shout out to Kathy, who has been one of my partners in crime in terms of doing this research, as well as there's a large team of people who are engaged in this research in the Institute and some of our international collaborators as well. So when I talk about word of mouth, what am I talking about? Well, I'm talking about consumer to consumer discussions. Okay, so we're not talking about companies talking to consumers, it's consumers talking to each other about products, brands, services, or the companies that manufacture them. So that's the domain here, is we're talking sort of out of really the direct marketing to consumer and to what people talk amongst themselves. And it's a really hot topic right now. It's interesting with any research, particularly in marketing, and probably it's probably true of all disciplines, it goes through fads. So you see like resurgence and then it drops down and then it bounces back up. Word of mouth has been like that. There was a lot of research done in the 60s that was all about particularly new product development and the role of word of mouth in that. Then it kind of died a bit, and then in the 90s it resurged again when services became really hot topic and the role of word of mouth in services a thing. Then it kind of died again, and then it came up again in more recently because of the lure of the internet. Now, why people are so interested in understanding word of mouth and part of the focus is there's probably four key things. First of all, it's kind of free. We don't pay for it as marketers. It's consumers talking amongst themselves. Now, of course, there are now programs that people put out there where they try to incentivize people to give referrals. I love the fact that in the US, my friends are worth $100 to one bank, but only $50 to another bank. I'm not sure if that's a reflection on my friends or the banks themselves. But you know, there's a lot of that happening out there. But generally, most word of mouth happens with consumers not in there. Because it's not controlled, it's a little bit sexy and exciting as well. If we can't control it, we always want to know what's going on and how we can possibly have an influence. A lot of hype about it being very powerful and credible. And this speaks to the lack of marketer control. So it's thought that, you know, people, you know, they put a lot of investments in the recommendations that they actually give. So the idea is that when someone receives a recommendation, it has a big effect on them, and it's part of that credibility. The resurgence, as I mentioned, is partly because of when, you know, we have this thing called the internet. Has anyone noticed that? That's kind of that. Anyway, and from a marketing and a word of mouth perspective, suddenly, wow, we can actually see conversations about our brands, which we couldn't do before. We could hear about them. We could ask people and hope they told us the truth. A few things where we would try could try and record what they were saying, but we really didn't know what was going on. But now we've got this whole world of online where we can see it. And there's a lot of ads now that ask people, go to our Facebook page. And I was in the US recently and they had, it was an ad for toilet paper, well, Cottonelle toilet wipes. And they told me to go to their Facebook page. And I thought, what do people write on a Facebook page for cotton, for, you know, toilet wipes? So I went and checked. Oh, sorry, before I get to that, despite the hype about internet online and word of mouth online, most word of mouth is still offline. Okay? It's really important to remember that despite all of the hype about the online world, word of mouth is still mostly one person talking to another person. Here's some statistics. This is from the Kellefay Group, who do a lot of research and tracking in word of mouth. 75% online. Here are some statistics across different categories. Even some of the most talked about categories still only have about 10% of their word of mouth given online. So while online gives us the ability to observe people's conversations, it's really important to remember that most of the action is actually offline. Most of the action is still our human interaction with people. Now back to toilet paper, because I don't want to lose that thread of conversation. What do they talk about on a toilet paper Facebook page? Well, that's what I got first presented with. I could get a coupon. And let's look at the conversation. So this is goes, Cottonelle, everyone out there is getting fresh with a friend, have you? Where's my coupon? I got my coupon, but I can't find the price. Thanks for the coupon. Got my coupon. Yeah, guess what? Everyone's talking about the coupons for it. There's not a lot of high engagement happening on there. And just lest you think it's just Cottonelle, I did check on a couple of other toilet paper sites. Yeah, and they were all the same. Yeah. So when we're talking about word of mouth, one thing to remember is because it's usually two people talking to each other, there are two parties involved. And this is often the mistake I find people make when they consider word of mouth. They focus on one side or the other side. We have both a giver and we have a receiver. And if we're really going to understand fully what word of mouth is about, we have to actually understand what's going on both sides, because they both influence the giving and the possible consequences of word of mouth occurring. So we're going to look at both of those. So first of all, let's find out, why do people give word of mouth? If you think about it, in the context of everything possibly we could talk about in the world, why on earth do we talk about brands? I mean, surely we've got better things to talk about sometimes. Yeah, let's go on. I think Kellefay found that in the US, people engage in, on average, 10 conversations about branded products every day. If we look at why people give word of mouth, there are three different categories we can look at. One is internal motivation, so things about me that make me want to speak out about something to the world. And if we look at these two groups here, if we look at positive word of mouth, there are three reasons why people give word of mouth. First of all, that are internal motivations. I say something positive because I'm really interested about a topic. So I've got a fascination about a particular category, so I want to share it with the world. To be helpful is one of the major categories people give word of mouth, because they perceive that the person who's receiving it will value the information. That's actually quite important, and I'll talk about that when we talk about the receiver and their ability to act on it. A third reason is to make yourself look good. If you give someone a recommendation, you sound like you know stuff. Yeah, makes you feel good, makes you look good. So to enhance ourselves is another internal reason why we give word of mouth. When it comes to negative word of mouth, we have some similarities. So negative word of mouth is when you say something not good about a brand. To be helpful, because negative word of mouth can be useful, helps someone avoid a bad situation. Vengeance is a reason particularly found for online word of mouth. When someone really annoys you and you just want to get back at them by telling as many people as possible is one of the motivations. People give negative word of mouth to reduce their anxiety. If you've had a bad experience and you're a bit traumatized by it, what do you do? Talk to your friends, tell them about it. The act of it helps you sort of get it off your chest. And another reason is to seek advice. So you might give word of mouth because you don't, negative word of mouth, because something happened to you and you don't quite know what to do about it or how you should react. So you ask, you tell other people, but the reason for you telling other people is so you can get advice about what you should do in that situation. So that's the first sort of group of reasons of why people give word of mouth. And those are the reasons that usually people focus on. But we have some other reasons why people give word of mouth. The environment and the context people are in also plays a big role. A lot of people give word of mouth about a brand or product because it just came up in conversation. They didn't plan it, they didn't really have any strong emotion, but people were talking about restaurants and someone goes, oh, hey, I went to this great Greek restaurant last week. Yeah. A lot of word of mouth is just because it came up in conversation. When people are asked for specific recommendations, so it wasn't an internal, I have to tell people, it's someone asked me, do you know a good restaurant? And sometimes we're just a little bit lost for words, so we're standing there with somebody and what do? We talk about something just to stimulate the conversation, and it might be an experience we have with a brand or something that we know in order to just move the conversation along. And then we have the company triggers for word of mouth, and these are the things that companies do that stimulate people to have conversations. Advertising. About Kellefay report, about 20% of advertising is of word of mouth is about advertising. You know, sometimes we do talk about things when they're interesting, creative. We have to be a little bit careful with this because, remember, often the conversation is about the advertising. That doesn't mean it's necessarily about the brand being advertised. And those are two very different things. Other marketing activities, so any sort of PR, all sorts of things that are going on, if there's a free sampling, things like that, these can all stimulate conversation. And if people have a newsworthy experience. So by newsworthy experience, early word of mouth research focused very much on the idea of satisfaction versus dissatisfaction as stimulus for word of mouth. But what it sort of missed the point is that just simply being satisfied isn't enough to stimulate word of mouth. And the reason for that is that's what we expect. You know, if I reach over, grab this glass of water, I expect I can have a drink and it will quench my thirst. I have my phone, I expect that I can make a call out of it, get what I need out of it. So I'm satisfied with that, but that's not really conversation, is it? It's not a conversation topic, me talking about how, yeah, guess what, my phone worked today. Yeah? Well, put it this way, I might not have many friends at the end of it who want to talk to me if that's my conversation. So when we have newsworthy experiences, when something really surprises us that's really good, or when it's really bad, that's when the company can stimulate conversation, when it's unusual for us. So the two key things I want you to take out of the first part of what I'm talking about here is that it's not just about satisfaction, dissatisfaction with word of mouth. There are lots of satisfied and dissatisfied people who don't actually say anything about the brand. Word of mouth is a social activity, so it's more important to be concerned about the newsworthiness of the information and the context and the environment. These are the things that really drive people giving word of mouth. We also find past history matters. Contrary to popular beliefs about ideas of mavens who go out and recommend everything and know everything about everything, most people only give recommendations or talk about things they've personally experienced. I'll talk a little bit about passing on later. There is some people who pass on word of mouth from other people, but it's still not very prevalent. Most people talk about their own experiences and give recommendations based on that. And we see that when we look at the data. Here's across a whole range of studies. This is positive word of mouth. These are the different categories that have been investigated. And the average is across the top there. So it was a whole range of different categories, but people were asked when they give last instance of word of mouth, was it about your current brand, a brand you've used previously, or one you've never used? And you can see the vast majority of word of mouth was about current brand, followed by a brand you've used previously. When we look at negative word of mouth, we find that most negative word of mouth is given by people who have previously used the brand. Okay. Current brand is second, and again, never used, not that common. So the key take out here is that brand size or the size of your customer base is a big impact on the volume of word of mouth you will receive. The more customers you have, the more people have the capacity to give word of mouth about you. But this is relative to other brands in the category. And this is for both positive and negative. So who actually gives positive word of mouth? Well, surprisingly, it's not the loyals, the people who've been around there for a long time. It's actually more likely to be newer customers. Okay, here we've got 5 studies across some banking products, supermarkets and hairdressers, and customers split by tenure. And you can see how the line goes down the longer someone's been there. Why is that? Well, it's news if it's new. When you go to a new hairdresser, you tell people. When you go to a hairdresser for the 10th time, not so much. Yeah? So when things are new and interesting to us, we're more likely to tell them to other people as well. What about males versus females? Always one of the old chestnuts in there. This is the audience participation part of the session. I've got some categories. I want you to tell me if you think men or women are more likely to talk about them. Bank accounts. Yep, it is men. Supermarkets. Yep, it is women. Holiday destinations. Yep, it is women. Computers. Yep, it is men. Restaurants. It is actually a mix of both. Women tend to talk about restaurants generally more, but men tend to talk more about sort of their main restaurant. What about if I ask you about whiskey? This is the trick. It actually depends on the profile of the category user. So if you notice, if I actually went back to those categories, women tend to be more the household shopper. So they talk more about supermarkets. Men tend to be more who's going to buy the computer. So they talk more about computers. If we look at whiskey and just look at whiskey buyers only, the actual number of brands recommended doesn't vary across gender. So it's really just an artifact of who is actually experiencing the category. So here's some work we've done across different countries. Now, one of the great myths out there is this idea that, you know, if you're satisfied, you tell four people. If you're dissatisfied, you had bad experience, you tell 14 people, which gives us the impression that there's so much more negative word of mouth out there than positive word of mouth. It's not true. No evidence to support that whatsoever. And I'll show you some data now. Okay, here's across a whole range of categories. This is the incidence per 100. This is the way it's done at this is to control for different sample sizes of positive word of mouth versus negative word of mouth. And you can see for every category, positive word of mouth is more common than negative word of mouth. Now, there's two reasons why this might be. It might be because more people give positive word of mouth, or the people who give positive word of mouth tell more people. Right? There's two possible reasons. We find that the reason is because many more people give positive word of mouth. People give positive and negative word of mouth at about the same rate. Okay? Well, and the reason for that's very, very simple. Most products work. Most services work. Many more people are satisfied and have a positive story to tell than are dissatisfied and have a negative story to tell. So your base of people who can say something positive is much greater than your base of people who can say something negative. Now, this is why we have less negative word of mouth. A lot of people are out of the market for negative word of mouth. They don't have anything bad to say. So this whole idea that there's lots of negative word of mouth out there, it's a myth. There isn't. You know, there's much more, we are much more positive than we are negative. There's also a lack of reinforcement. I mean, particularly for products, our work we do in television programs, when we track new programs over time and the negative word of mouth, what happens is it kind of goes down as time goes on about a program. Why? Because if you didn't like it, you stop watching. So then you have nothing to talk about. You don't keep talking about a program you watched 4 weeks ago that you didn't like. So therefore, the amount of negative word of mouth actually declines for programs over time because they don't have reinforcement to say that. Age is another old chestnut of that. It's all the young people are talking. Well, it's actually not young people that are talking, it's just what we notice is a large drop-off in who gives word of mouth after the age of 54. Why might that be? Why might people be talking less to other people after 54? You retire. Well, some do. But a lot of people leave the workforce or now in part-time, so what happens is their social network shrinks. So they have less people to talk to, so therefore they have less opportunity to give, and I could show you the slides for receive, they're the exact same. So we notice that it's not so much that all the young people are talking, it's that it drops off as people get to an age where their social network is not as strong, or not as wide. So the key takeouts from here and say is forget the stereotypes and cliches. There are a lot of them out there, a lot of hype, a lot of myths about word of mouth. Okay? Positive word of mouth is much more common than negative word of mouth. And people's propensity to give word of mouth depends very much on their experience with the category. It's not defined by their gender, their age. There aren't these nice little groups of people all talking. It's whoever engages with the category. So now we're going to move to the receiver. Okay, so this is the person getting the word of mouth. As I mentioned previously, we like to be helpful. It's part of our innate people issue. Well, most of us do. Okay, there's a few of you out there, I'm sure, who are going, no, I don't help anybody. But most of us like to be helpful. And what this means in terms of who we give word of mouth to or who gets our word of mouth is we shape it according to who is we think is going to get value from it. So if I know the date that Gossip Girl is coming back on air, I'm much more likely to share it with Kathy than I am with Jerry. Any prizes for guessing why? Yeah. So that's it. We shape our word of mouth according to who we think will benefit from it in there. So this is one of the reasons. So we're not out there randomly just giving word of mouth to everybody we come along. Or if we are, we're a little bit crazy. So we're actually shaped, and this is why word of mouth will always be limited in its reach, for two reasons. One is, not everybody we know actually is going to, we perceive, will find this useful. And secondly, for us it gets old even as stories. You know, when you're about the fourth time you've told a story, you're really not that interested anymore in your own conversation, let alone the poor person you're talking to. Now, consumers do go out and seek word of mouth, but sought word of mouth is a lot less than we might think. Here are some categories, and you look at some of them like primary schools, fashion stores, movie, you know, some of them are categories that we might think there's a lot of sought word of mouth. There's also a lot of unsought word of mouth. Yeah. A lot of times people just get recommendations that are shaped actually by the giver's perception as much as the receiver's need for that word of mouth. Okay. So this means that even if someone has the potential to give word of mouth, they may not if they don't perceive that the person they're talking to will get value of that information. Okay? So it's not just anything goes, we actually shape it. So okay, so if someone gives an instance of word of mouth, what can possibly happen as a result of that? Okay, so a word of mouth happens in a forest. What could possibly happen? There are six possible outcomes. I'll talk about how each of these fit in. But we can find that there are six things that can happen, or not happen as in one case, when someone says something that is word of mouth. First, I'm going to talk about these two, nudging and persuasion. By persuasion, what I mean is a big change. I wasn't going to do something and, whoa, now I'm going to do it, now that you've recommended it. No way I was going to see that movie, but now you've told me it's fabulous, that's it, I'm there. Nudging, what I'm talking about is, oh yeah, I was kind of inclined to see that movie, and yeah, I'm now a little bit more inclined to see that movie. Okay? Two very different effects. With word of mouth, we often focus on this idea of persuasion, that it is a big, powerful impact on people. But it can't be all of the time, and part of this is because what I talked about previously in people shaping who they give word of mouth to. And I'm going to talk you through this in terms of, because this is actually a really important thing and why I think historically we've kind of overstated the impact of word of mouth. It's because we forgot where people are coming from when before they receive it. So to really be able to measure the impact of word of mouth, you need to know basically how likely was the receiver to act beforehand. Because it's not like everybody starts at zero. Often people have got some notion of what they might do, this, particularly when they're seeking word of mouth about something. I mean, one of the things Kathy found in her research was that when people did seek word of mouth about a TV program or movie, it was usually about a specific TV. It wasn't, what should I watch on TV tonight? It was, should I watch Private Practice tonight? You know, it was actually about something people already had in their mind that they might act positively towards. Depending on where they are, you've got to work out whether there's room for change from that. I'll talk about this in a sec. And this room for change defines whether you can have a persuasion or a nudging outcome. What I mean by room for change is, imagine we've got two things here. We've got the initial probability of purchase of somebody on a 0 to 10 scale, and then we've got the possible impact of an instance of word of mouth. Now, if someone's at 0, potentially hearing a word of mouth could take me up to 10. Yeah? So that's a big room for change. That's what I would call a persuasion effect. I wasn't going to do it, now I'm definitely going to do it. If I was at one, I've got nine I could move. So I can still make a big leap. But as I move down, if I'm here at seven, so there's a 7 out of 10 chance that I was going to do it, hearing word of mouth can take me only a little way further. And if I'm at 10, if I was going to do it, hearing some positive word of mouth can't have any effect on me because I was going to do it anyway. So there's no additional benefit that the word of mouth actually has. And this is why the fact of, because if you don't take into account those initial probabilities, the fact that the giver often shapes who they give the word of mouth to people they know are going to be interested, so are more likely to be at this end of the scale, means that perhaps in the past we've often overstated the effect of word of mouth. They've behaved positively to the brand after receiving the word of mouth, but what we didn't realise is they were going to do it anyway, most of them. Now, if we have negative word of mouth, we have the reverse thing. So, if I'm at zero, if I was not going to buy something, hearing something negative about it, what effect does that have? Nothing. Because I wasn't going to do it anyway. So me telling you, for example, that in Split and Croatia, the Best Western Art Hotel has the worst coffee I've ever come across, what effect does that have on your purchase behaviour? Nothing. Any of you planning to go to Croatia anytime soon? No? Well, okay. So that was lost. So the Best Western Art Hotel actually has had no detriment from me saying this. Now, of course, once it's on the internet and it does reach Croatia and maybe it will, think. But in this room, no effect. And as we move up, again, as we start to get towards where people are more certain, then we've got more potential for a negative instance of word of mouth to have an effect. Now, there is an exception to this, is what we do find is people a little bit stickier if they're really certain of doing something. Hearing one instance of negative word of mouth often isn't enough to dissuade people. There's a little bit of stickiness at the end, you know, if you're really certain. And likewise, if you're definitely not, some people have actually actively rejected the choice. So hearing one instance of positive word of mouth is actually not going to have that effect. But I'll show you some data in the middle that shows that what I'm describing here actually happens in real life. Here's a chart of the effect of positive word of mouth. So this is some real data. The effect of size on the side, so the effect of receiving the word of mouth, the impact that had on people's probability of purchase. And down the side, we have people split according to where they were beforehand. And what you can see is when people had low probability of acting, the word of mouth, the positive word of mouth, had a bigger effect that tapers off as people had a higher probability. Because it has to. It's actually a mathematical thing. It's not really any rocket science. It's just most of the word of mouth research actually hasn't taken this into account. It assumes everybody has the potential to go all the way up. And that's really not what we find. With negative word of mouth, we find the reverse. Down there at the low end, you can see that negative word of mouth actually has no effect. However, as we start to get up into the middle there, that's when negative word of mouth can have the most effect. If you're not so sure, hearing something negative about something can make you, oh, well, I don't need to worry about that, particularly if you've got lots of other options. And this is what I was talking about there around one, the stickiness at the end, the fact that there are people, if you're actually really certain, hearing negative word of mouth doesn't necessarily make you totally change your mind. You may discount it. Another shock is that when you control for these initial probabilities, positive and negative word of mouth have exactly the same effect on people. Which actually, if you think about it from a consumer perspective, makes perfect sense. I mean, we talk about positive and negative, but to the consumer, it's all just advice. The positive and negative is actually to the brand. It's not to the consumer. It's just telling me I can make a better decision because this is good, or I can make a better decision by avoiding this. But to the consumer, it's all just advice. So positive word of mouth, negative word of mouth, it's not more common, it's not more impactful than positive word of mouth. Word of mouth has a similar impact on all ages. Okay, doesn't matter. And here's a slide from Kathy. It also has similar impact whether it's online or offline. We investigated this because we thought maybe in the online environment people might be talking to strangers, so it might be less credible, so they might not act. Actually, we found, first of all, in the online environment people talk to their friends and people they know. Shock, horror. You know, we actually don't spend a lot of our time on the internet randomly talking to strangers, just like we don't in real life, generally. And the impact of word of mouth is pretty much the same. Now the other effects I'm going to touch on briefly, because we still need to do a fair bit of research into this area, but it is worthwhile knowing that it's not just about the receiver acting as the impact of word of mouth. Passing on is the act of when you tell someone else about word of mouth you've received. So I haven't seen the movie, but my sister told me it was fabulous. Okay, so I tell someone else the advice my sister gave me. We find that it varies a lot across instances, but we're doing some work to sort of benchmark how much this actually happens. A contrary impact. Sometimes we tell someone something positive and it makes them less likely to act. We can all think of perhaps advice from our mother that maybe fits into that category. We did actually test this in some research we were doing on TV, where we asked people to their initial probability, their revised probability, and then if the advice made the probability, if the advice was positive but it made the probability go down, we asked them why. And it was really sensible things like, I don't like what they like. People did that. It happens, it doesn't happen very often again. Most of the time it's in the direction. We're talking about 3% of word of mouth has a contrary effect. Reinforcement. This is a field that really hasn't been studied, but one of the reasons we don't often act on our own attitudes to something is because we forget. I don't know how many times I've stood there, like looking particularly at wine, and I look at all these labels and I go, I know I've drunk that. Did I like it? I can't remember. Yeah, and maybe it's the wine, but still, yeah. So the fact that there's a lot of brands out there and it's hard to remember which ones you liked and things. So when you tell someone else about your feelings towards something, it reminds you how you felt. So there's a reinforcement effect on the giver when they give word of mouth. We don't know exactly how much that effect is, still needs to be researched. It's a really tricky one to research because you've got to control for a whole heap of things, but hopefully we'll tackle that soon. And of course there's no effect. Yeah. A lot of word of mouth happens and nothing happens as a result of it. We did some research actually asking people who gave word of mouth what effect they expected the word of mouth to have. And interestingly, about 30 to 40% of them said nothing, really. They didn't actually expect the receiver to do anything as a result of their word of mouth. Other things were things like, make them laugh. So we often think people are giving it because of the company and to do things with it, but sometimes it's just conversation. So it's important, what I want you to take away from this is that word of mouth is not just a road to Damascus conversion. You hear, you do, you act. It's actually a complex social phenomena, and we need to take that into account when we're looking at the full effects of what an instance of word of mouth can have. Positive and negative word of mouth have same impact, so we don't have to worry about that. Negative word of mouth isn't very common, but when it does happen, the world falls apart. No evidence to support that. And positive word of mouth has the most impact when it reaches people who have a low propensity to buy from the brand. And that's really important because that's the big challenge of word of mouth. It's actually quite hard because the giver is not inclined to give it to people they don't think have a high propensity to act. So let's look at some things to do with measurement, because without measurement, we have no management. And so, you know, and measuring word of mouth is a bit of a tricky one because there's a lot of things that people don't take into account when they're considering. And one of the big things is the fact that we have a giver and a receiver. And depending on what your objectives are, you might want to focus on either or both. The giver, well, you want to talk to the giver when you want to look at the effectiveness of any activities to generate word of mouth. Okay? So if you've got a program in place, if you've called for recommendations, you really need to, you know, ask the giver ask people whether they've given word of mouth. But you also need to take into account their prior experience with the brand so that you can control for that, because to understand if the word of mouth level you're getting is normal, you need to know how, you know, if you're a big brand or a small brand relative to competitors, you need to control for that. Because bigger brands have more customers, so they'll get more word of mouth. Now, if you know that, you can then look out for when it's higher than expected. And that gives you more insight as to whether your program is actually working. If we look at the receiver, this is when we're looking at the effect of the word of mouth that's given. Just looking at the giver doesn't tell us whether or not anything happened as a result. So you would look at the receiver if you're looking at the contribution of word of mouth to sales, where your new customers came from, and the contribution to word of mouth as a media channel. Does it reach people that maybe your conventional advertising is not reaching? But you also need to, in this process, actually understand where people are before they receive the word of mouth. If we're looking at online versus offline measurements, both have pros and cons. And we've used both techniques and found them useful in different forums. Online is useful when you want to know what's been given. If you want to do a content analysis, as Kathy has done, and I'm sure she'd be willing to share it with you if you want to talk to her during the drinks. If you want to look at volume, how much is out there, it's a good way to do it. And if you want to look at timing, because they can record exactly when things have happened. I was at MIT a couple of weeks ago, and there they're looking at projects where they're matching what happens on TV with what conversations are happening online. And they're matching up the exact times of these happen to work out whether or not what is being screened, the program or the ad, is actually stimulating conversation. However, offline is better at received word of mouth, because in the online space you don't know who got it, you only know it was given. If you want to determine impact, you need to do this offline. You can't do this online, it's not possible. When people differ, if you want to look at different groups, because when you're just looking at what's happening in the online space, and by here I just wanted to qualify, I'm not talking about online data collection methods of offline behaviour. I'm talking about things like Nielsen Buzz metrics and monitoring of online conversations in here. But whenever you want to divide people into groups, you really need to do that offline. And if you want to look at valence, positive and negative, you really need to do that offline so that you can check that, because trying to code valence secondhand is very tricky, because there's a lot of inference in a written piece that you can't get, because you can't get tone as well as you can in a conversation. And one important final point is on how many of you have heard of the Net Promoter Score? Not many. Oh, maybe I shouldn't do this piece then, because it's rubbish and I really don't want to talk about it if I don't have to. I'll talk about it very briefly, because you probably come across it in some form. It has been very popular and hopefully is dying a sad death. It's all about measuring whether what people intend to do in terms of, do you intend to give word of mouth? Would you like to give word of mouth? Do you want to give word of mouth about something? Versus measuring if people did give word of mouth. And if you're talking about intention versus behaviour, we'd recommend just worrying about the behaviour, because our evidence in the intention is it's really not very useful. Here's a TV program example. We collected history TV programs and we asked people whether or not they intend to give word of mouth in the next week. And after a week, we recontacted them and found out if they had. So then we split people into intenders and non-intenders, and we found out how many people actually did what they said they were going to do. So of the intended people who intended to give word of mouth about MasterChef, only 43% of them did. And for Castle, only a measly 17% of them actually end up giving word of mouth about Castle. However, people were very good at telling us what they weren't going to do. So those who said, I'm not going to recommend that brand, yeah, most of them didn't. No, people are better at predicting what they won't do than what they will. Why did intenders fail to recommend? Well, they just said, I was too busy. Didn't think about it. You know, it's not that important a thing, recommending a brand. So asking people what they want to do, they will give you an answer, but it doesn't mean they'll actually do it. Curiously asking why the non-intenders did recommend, and it was because some of the reasons I talked about in terms of the triggers, the environmental things that people can't take into account. So yeah, my wife asked me about, these are real quotes that people gave us. I was cooking with someone, we started talking about MasterChef. Someone didn't plan to talk about MasterChef, it just happened because that was the conversation. And if we look at the actual behaviour of the different groups in terms of their intention, we find that, you know, these are some from some banking categories. Those people with, 6 months given and positive and negative word of mouth. These are the people who had a 0 to 6 probability of actually giving word of mouth. And you can see that, well, about 10% of them did give positive word of mouth and about 10% of them also gave negative word of mouth. So they actually gave about the same, positive and negative. Those people are called the passives. Well, they actually were pretty active for the passives. And of those who gave a 9 out of 10 probability, for personal banking, about half of them didn't. Not very nice, are they? They said they would and they ended up not doing it. So, you know, we have to take a lot of people's claims about our intention, particularly about something like word of mouth, in a grain of salt. When people are usually answering these questions, they're usually just giving you a reflection of how much they like the brand, which you can ask them in much better ways than pretending that it's about word of mouth. Okay, so key takeouts from this section is measure behaviour, not intention. Pretty much in any field you can say that. You always get a better read on things if you ask what people have done, not what they want to do. And think about why you're measuring word of mouth, and so you can really get a handle on whether you should be talking to the giver, the receiver, or both. And that will impact the method that you use to collect that. So I'm finally going to end with some action points. So for those of you who are interested in how do I actually implement this and use this, well, let's answer some questions. So you want to stimulate word of mouth. What do? Give people something to talk about. Okay? Don't assume that just simply your brand experience will let people, suddenly the masses will start the conversation, because quite frankly, it wasn't that interesting. And I mean that with no disrespect, but all of you, it wasn't that interesting. So what you need to do is to think about what's the curious things, what's the unusual things, what are the surprising things about your brand that people might actually find worthy of passing on to someone else. You know, what's the story? Inject that in, get that to people to talk about. The other thing is, people who are new to your customer base, they're the ones who have a natural inclination to say something positive. So harness that. We've just been doing some work on decay. What we find with a product experience is quite a steep curve, a decay curve down. So you've got a short window of opportunity where something is newsworthy. Use it, harness it, try and encourage it. So you're worried about negative word of mouth. First of all, check, is this really a problem? I think sometimes we overinflate it, and don't just check online, because one of the things in terms of, you know, the idea of vengeance being a way of people posting things online, It's not where the bulk of conversation is. So before you go running around trying to solve your negative word of mouth problem, really check that there is a negative word of mouth problem. And if there is the case that you do stuff up, that will be a situation where people have something negative to talk about. Change the conversation, do something positive. Okay? You've done something bad, that's fine. Do something positive to make up for it. So the conversation is about the makeup, not the screw up. So you want your word of mouth to have impact. Well, then try get out to non-users and be wary of forums that attract heavy users of your brand. Okay? Now you really want to get out to the masses with your word of mouth if you want it to have impact. You want to measure it. Make sure you control for prior probabilities. Don't neglect the other effects. So some of them are quite small, and when we have some more figures on the actual incidents, we'll have a better idea of what to prioritise. But don't always assume that it's just the receiver that will necessarily benefit from the word of mouth. Might be some other unintended effects that you hadn't thought about. Some other questions that people often have. Should I stop advertising and just focus on word of mouth? No. Word of mouth is limited in your capacity to control it. Advertising lets you control content, volume, and distribution. That's actually what you pay for. With word of mouth, you lose this control. What you're left is kind of relying on the goodwill of consumers to pass on about your brand, and that's a very risky strategy. Is it better to create advertising that's talked about? Maybe that's the best of both worlds. I get advertising, I get people talking about it. Well, the reality is that most advertising is talked about for creative, not for the brand. Did some research on this a while back, and it was when two ads were shown that really people were talking about a lot. One was an Optus ad that had a big giraffe talking thing. So it was like a very nice, well-liked ad. The other was, I don't know if you remember, the Mentos ad about nipples. They had the nipples growing. It actually got complained about. Okay, well, the thing. Anyway, both of these ads topped when we asked people, what ads have you been talking about? Right? They're both very talked about ads. One was really well liked, the Optus ad. The Mentos ad, not so much liked. However, when we asked people, what brand was it for? Only a third in both instances actually knew the brand being advertised. They knew the ad, they just didn't know the brand. Okay? So be careful, if you're getting an ad that's being talked about, make sure it's your brand that's being talked about, not the creative. What about social media? This is another avenue for people to talk, but it is very transient. I mean, yeah, we've all got Facebook and whatever, but how many times do you read every single post on there? There's a lot that goes on in Facebook world that we don't pay any attention to, just like in real life. Okay? So just because it's written doesn't mean it's permanent and people are paying attention to it. And if you have a branded site, you really need to understand the profile of what you're doing. We're doing some research now that's looking at profiling, for example, Facebook users, and there's some really exciting results coming out of that. Okay, well that's it from me. Does anyone have any questions?